welcome to the chapter one read aloud for the March Cozy Escape Book Club pick, which is Kitty Confidential by Molly Fitz. Now, this is book one in the Pet Whisper PI series, and there are a ton of books inside of there. I have read all of them, so I won't do any spoilers, but I can confirm that it is an amazing series. It is like literally my favorite cozy mystery series, totally worth reading. So I'm going to read chapter one. Hopefully you'll get excited about it. And after you listen to this, head over to Courtney's channel for chapter two. And then of course, sign up for the Cozy Escape Book Club because it's free, it's fun, and you get to connect with other amazing people who also love talking about cozy mysteries. Now, at the end of the month, we will be talking about this book on the very last Wednesday of March. I don't have a calendar right near me, but we always talk the very last Wednesday of every month for whatever the book club discussion was for that month, and it is always at 7 p.m. Central Standard Time. So I will leave a link to that below as well. So let's go ahead and jump into this month's book. Chapter one. The first thing you should know about me is that I hate lawyers. The second is that I work for them. I didn't plan it this way, not one bit. I was going to be a huge star, leave Blueberry Bay behind without so much as a farewell glance over my shoulder as I booked it the heck out of here. The problem with that plan was, well, you need talent in order to be a star, and I never had much of that. At least, not that I've discovered. Yet. When the temp agency assigned me to work for Fulton Thompson Associates as their new paralegal, I almost said no, but then I saw those dollar signs and remembered how rent is a thing that exists. And so here I am, doing the needful to get by as I continue down that elusive path toward fame by eliminating every possible talent one at a time. Stands to reason, if I keep at it long enough, I'll eventually find my true calling. Who knows? I could be the world's best hip-hop yodeler. Except I already tried that, and I'm not. It's fine, really. I'm enjoying the journey, although I sure do wish the destination would hurry up and get here already. Hi, I'm Angie Russo, and one day you're going to see my name in lights. You see, my nan used to be a celebrated Broadway actress back in the day. That is, until she quit at the peak of her career to retire to Glendale, Maine, and raise her family. Before you ask, no, I can't sing, dance, or act, but Nan assures me that I have star power in my blood, just like she did and just like my mom. Oh, yeah, you probably know my mom. She's the news anchor from Channel 7, and my dad does the sports report. Seeing as they're these huge career types, it was Nan who did most of the work raising me, and that suited me just fine. In fact, I'd still be living with her even now if she hadn't given me a gentle push out of the nest and told me it was time to fly. That was about a year ago and happened just shortly after I collected my 7th consecutive associate degree from Blueberry Bay Community College. Yes, indeed. I've always loved learning anything I could wrap my brain around. At least God did me a solid by making me smart. Even if he made my unique talents hard to find, one of my degrees is in fact for paralegal studies and law administration services, which may seem like a strange thing to study for someone who hates lawyers as much as I do, but that's a story for another time. This is a story of how I almost died, and it's a good one. So super excited. She is someone that's just like me, has a million different interests, which is why she doesn't have a college degree, but instead has 7 community college degrees, which probably is what would have happened to me if I had not gone to a 4-year college. All right. I began my day by sniff testing 2 blazers with the goal of choosing whichever was the cleanest for a will reading at the office that day. Both smelled vaguely of sweat and gym shoes, meaning either would earn me a stern lecture from the partners. Then again, maybe that's precisely what I've deserved for putting off that trip to the dry cleaners for so long. After spraying a cough-inducing fog of deodorizer into my closet, I plucked the neon pink jacket off its hanger and pushed my arms into the sleeves. A black and white polka dot blouse and stretchy leggings completed the outfit perfectly. Because I didn't have time to wash my hair that morning, I pulled my poofy shoulder-length hair into a messy bun and accentuated the do with the cute barrette I picked up earlier in the week from my favorite dollar store. And before you can ask, no, I didn't have time for dry cleaning, and yes, I always had time for the dollar store. On that particular morning, I didn't have time for either one, though. In fact, I'd spent so much time agonizing over which blazer to wear that I'd pretty much run out of time altogether. I'm already not a morning person, but when you add in a manic rush to get to a job I don't even like, well, I could already tell just how bad this day would end up. I raced out the door unshowered, unfed, and uncaffeinated, hoping that I'd at least have some luck and catch all the green lights on my commute that day. Instead, the longest train in the world cut me off not even 2 blocks from my house. The train tracks run along the only major street to serve our small coastal town, and there's absolutely no way for me to reach the firm via back roads, which meant I found myself stuck waiting in a line of angry honking cars for a good, solid 15 minutes. By the time I actually reached the office, I was the last one through the door, and we had less than 10 minutes until the will reading commenced. My hope to sneak in undetected proved unfounded as well. Russo, Mr. Thomas bellowed, Thompson bellowed before the door even closed all the way behind me. If you pictured an old white guy wearing boat shoes and an ascot, you'd have a pretty good idea of how Mr. Thompson looked and an even better idea of how he acted. He was a fantastic lawyer, but not a very personable boss. A thick, meaty vein pulsed at the side of his head, and for some reason I couldn't stop staring at it. He pointed at me with a shaking finger and a scowl. Late and dressed like you're attending an 80s-themed party instead of a will reading. Nope, that's not going to fly today. Go see if Peters has a jacket you can borrow. It took the strength of 1,000 bodybuilders not to roll my eyes as I slumped off to find the only female associate in the whole place. We often got grouped together by nature of our shared gender, but Bethany Peters and I were nothing alike. She was blonde and pretty and looked like she would should be sweet as pie, too, except she was actually the biggest shark of them all. I guess you have to be in order to get taken seriously in a man's world. But what did I know? I was just a glorified secretary who didn't even want to be there. Bethany turned her nose up at me the second I entered her office, and I pinched my fingers over mine. See, Bethany had an obsession with essential oils and even sold them in these tacky online parties that she invited us all to once a month. Even at the point, I'd only worked at the firm for a few months but had already ordered more lavender bath salts than I could ever possibly need. On the day of the will reading, Bethany's office reeked of juniper and lemon. Definitely not one of her better combinations, but still, whatever blend of restorative girl power mojo she was trying to concoct, I sincerely hoped it would work for her. Let me guess, she said in that nastily condescending tone that she had always used whenever talking to me or one of the other employees without a law degree. Fulton sent you in to borrow a jacket from me. A smile crept across my face. Thompson, actually. Call me a contrarian, but I loved getting the chance to prove her wrong, especially when a day started off as bad as this one had. It was a small and beautiful gift. Can't you pick up some appropriate work clothes for yourself so you're not always stuck borrowing mine last minute? She sighed before slumbering over to the other side of her office with those loose arms and large exaggerated strides. She looked like a preppy blonde gorilla, but I decided to keep that particular comparison to myself. Thompson, Fulton, they're both kind of freaking out lately, Bethany confided in me. Apparently the old lady that died is related to Fulton. How do you know? My eyes grew wide. So this was why everyone was making such an unusually large fuss this morning. Well, for starters, her last name is Fulton, too. She tapped on her temple to draw my attention to her superior brain power. I tapped on my head and shot her an ugly grimace in response. Now we're both office gorillas, and what an exhibit the pair of us made. Bethany chuckled as she handed me the most boring navy blue blazer God ever put on this green earth. Try to keep it together for the reading, huh? I nodded while switching jackets. The blazer pinched at my armpits, but I knew better than to complain. Thanks, I muttered, narrowly escaping Bethany's office before she could once again remind me that Goodwill or the Salvation Army were nice places to find clothes within my budget. I'd lose the barrette, she shouted after me. Oh, so close. But since Bethany tended to be like a dog with a bone once she had an idea, I pulled my cute little accessory out, taking a few caught hairs with it. The bun came out next, and I quickly finger-combed my hair to make it semi-presentable. Hopefully that would be enough to make everyone happy. Angie, is that you, Mr. Fulton? The senior-most partner called from inside the conference room. For whatever reason, Thompson always uses our last names, and Fulton sticks to our first. Maybe that was their way of playing good lawyer, bad lawyer, or maybe they just like to keep us on our toes. And I put on my best smile. After all, the guy did just lose a family member. Good morning, sir. Can I help you with something? His eyes lingered on my face briefly before he cleared his throat and pointed to the dusty old coffee maker in the corner of the room. We're going to need lots of coffee, and since you're a bit late this morning, I'm afraid there's no time to make a run to the barista. You'll have to use our backup maker. As strong as you can make it, please. I'm on it. We didn't use the in-house coffee maker very often, and really once kept it around, and really only kept it around for code red caffeine emergencies. The fact we needed it now is definitely not a good sign. In fact, I'd never actually used that old thing at all. The one time I'd almost had the chance, an intern burst into the office carrying a tray of Starbucks and let me off the hook. This ancient thing shouldn't be too hard to figure out, though. After all, I had 7 associate's degrees. Mr. Thompson, Bethany, and a few of the other associates entered while I was fiddling with the roast basket, which for some reason refused to line up with the necessary grooves in the machine. Normally, we'd have 1 or 2 lawyers present at a reading, but they seemed to be pulling out all the stops for this one. Was it just because the person who died was related to one of the partners, or was something more going on here? My curiosity had definitely been piqued by this point. Working in my corner, I caught a few snippets of the discussion happening around the conference room table. Our day-to-day conversations at the office at the firm were normally pretty dry, but things sounded refreshingly juicy today. Admittedly, it is a somewhat unusual situation, Thompson said first. Later, Fulton said, given the stipulations, I'm expecting one of the grantees to contest. An associate named Brad set up a tape recorder. Yes, another ancient relic living in our office, and Bethany shuffled a bunch of papers around. When the coffee maker's basket snapped into place, I let out a triumphant yip, drawing the aggravated stares from my colleagues. I'll just be right back, I promised, as I rushed past the growing crowd with the empty coffee pot. A beautiful blonde woman wearing a matching cardigan set and a strip of pink pearls stopped me before I could make it to the kitchen tap. Angie, I'm so glad I ran into you. Diane Fulton, Mr. Fulton's wife, shook her head and knitted her overplucked brow. Did you catch last night's episode? Even though Diane dresses like a blue blood snob, she was actually the coolest person in the entire world. She and I had a whole list of reality shows we liked to watch together and discuss whenever she came by the office to visit her husband for lunch. My eyes widened as she waited for my response. I may have been late to work, but I would never be late when it came to our shows. I couldn't believe Trace got eliminated, I answered with a tragic sigh as I turned on the faucet and let water fill the coffee pot. Hopefully he'll still get a record deal out of the whole thing. Let's catch up later, she told me with a slight frown. She pointed to the conference room and knitted her brow again. And I felt just awful for her. I heard, my condolences. You weren't close, were you? She stared at me for a moment as if she hadn't heard the question. Her dangling earrings were so long they hit her cheek as she shook her head. Ethel was Richard's great aunt. She was very old and had been sick for a long time. I think we were all expecting her to go sooner rather than later. Still, that sucks, I offered. Diane gave me a polite smile, then excused herself. Seriously, the best I could come up with that sucks? Good thing none of my degrees were in counseling. Then again, maybe it wouldn't be the worst idea in the world to go back to school. After all, school had always been my happy place. That was part of how I'd ended up with so many degrees to begin with. I returned with a full carafe of water and a bag of coffee grounds that had expired sometime last year, but thankfully still smelled fresh. During my very brief absence, the meeting room had filled with even more folks. The Fultons must have been one big family. Either that or Great Aunt Ethel had been one wealthy and presumably generous woman. Mr. Fulton looked at me with one eyebrow raised in question. Almost ready, I assured him as I rushed past the room of people to my quiet little coffee maker corner. Quick as I could, I filled up the tank with my freshly gotten water, scooped some grounds into the filter, and pressed the big red button to initiate the brewing process. Nothing happened. So I pushed it again, and again, and another 13 times to no effect. Plugging it in would help, Bethany shouted loud enough for everyone to hear and causing them all to laugh at me and my well-meaning incompetence. Ugh, talk about wicked embarrassing. I feel like that's something I would do, right? And I feel like there's a coworker there like Bethany who would totally call me out very happily. I groped around the back of the machine till I found the cord. Everyone was still laughing when I pushed the plug into the closest socket. First, I felt a gentle prick on my fingertips. Then my entire body lit with pain. For about 2 milliseconds, I became hyper-conscious of my surroundings, every smell, sound, feeling, even what the air in that room tasted like just then. The individual laughs transformed into a collective gas that tore through the room. And then with a sharp buzz, it all fell away, and I fell unconscious to the floor. That's the end of chapter one. Chapter two is so good. I'm kind of sad that I can't also read chapter two to you. So you need to go over to Courtney's channel and listen to chapter two of Kitty Confidential. Super excited about this book. I can't even tell you. Make sure to join the Cozy Escape Book Club and then join our Facebook group so we could talk all about it all month. And yeah, can't wait to talk more. And I'll try my best on the month-end group discussion. Do not give any spoilers because I have read the whole series or what's been written so far. So I know everything. Anyways, I hope everyone's having a fabulous weekend. And remember, on this channel, we're only talking about Cozy Escape from here on out and forever. And anything author writerly is going to be over on the Lisa London channel because I'm having like a branding crisis. I don't know what I'm doing. I honestly think like at this point, I'm probably just going to stick with Lisa London and Lisa Latte might just go away because it's so much work to do two author brands. So I might just put everything under one name. Again, I'm just talking like the last video where I said goodbye, just talking and talking, and it just keeps changing. So anyways, I'm just going to be nose to the grindstone writing all of March, all of April, and then I'm possibly back to YouTube in May. I don't know. If I'm having like a good writing time, I might just not come back. So if you do want to hang out with me though, I am for the first time ever, like ever, offering one-on-one author services. So make sure to check that out. It is over on the lisalondonbooks.com channel. And at the very top right, there's a little tab that says work with me. So anyways, I will hopefully see you for the book club discussion at the end of the month for my favorite cozy mystery book ever that you're totally going to love. Or I'll see you in maybe a one-on-one service or whenever I come back to YouTube. All right, I'll talk to you guys later. Bye.